Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Millionaire Dentist Podcast, brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. On this podcast, we break down the world of dentistry finances and business practices to help you become the millionaire dentist you deserve to be. Please be advised, we do speak with an honest tongue and may not be safe for work.
Hello and welcome. This is Casey Hires back at the Millionaire Dentist Podcast with co-host Jarrod Bridgman.
Hey, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
Great.
Looking dapper. And we also have special guest Steve Levy. He is our resident attorney, even though we don't offer legal services officially. And he's also a CPA, just one of those overachievers. You have six letters after your name. I have zero. I'm not feeling inadequate. We're good. Welcome.
Hello, hello.
So for our audience today, we have a time-sensitive topic. It's the Health and Human Services Distribution, aka free money. It is taxed, wah wah, but free money. So we brought Steve in. He helps our clients make sure that all of their paperwork, for lack of a better word, or electronic work is submitted. We're on top of that as a concierge firm. We do that for our folks, but we wanted to kind of do a public service announcement today for our listeners and potentially our listeners' friends who could miss out on this. So Steve, let's just kick it off. First, thanks for joining us, but what is this HHS Phase 4 distribution all about?
Well, as the title says, this is Phase 4 of what's been done basically in four phases up till now. The first one was a real minor phase of just small dollars. Two and three were substantial. Some folks got in the six digits for combined with the two phases. It's very similar to the prior two stages in that the government is looking to reimburse or supplement for lost wages, increased expenses as a result of COVID. And this is the way they're doing it. This is another phase they're doing it. It's a little different from the others, but we'll probably get into that a little later.
Absolutely. Santa Claus is coming to town. More free money. I know I've talked to a lot of practice owners who actually have a you know, more in their practice accounts than they've had in a long time, and a lot of it is due to some of these things. I know some of them actually kind of feel a little bad about it because they're doing well, but you know, that's neither here nor there. If there's opportunities as a practice owner, as somebody who took risk to go to dental school, to own a practice, to have staff and payroll, you took those risks. If this is part of what's going on, you at least need to be aware. And I think that's important to understand. So how does walk through how somebody qualifies for this payment? Who should be paying attention to this?
Well, we'll focus on dental providers, but it's really a broad spectrum of folks that are eligible as long as they're practicing in health. And even if they haven't been doing it for very long, it could even be those that started in 2020.
Like healthcare, anything health related?
Anything health related.
How about if somebody opens a massage business?
That might not qualify. That might be on the fringe of qualification. If they're writing a prescription of any type, that might qualify. There are certain databases that the Health and Human Services will cross-check to make sure it's in one of their qualifying categories for that.
I would imagine a majority of our listeners qualify, but just curious, Jarrod. I know you're trying. You got an up and coming massage business.
I was trying to think of a way to get some of that free money for myself. To be honest,
I saw the wheels turning.
I was trying.
Well, and that's why you got to. You know, you need to consult the attorney and CPA in house so you don't get yourself
right.
in trouble.
That's right. Steve. Okay, so let's say I did have a medical type business, you know, and I can apply. How do I? Like, what do I have to do to apply for this?
Well, first off, you have until October 26th to apply. So there is time, although there's a process for it. The Health and Human Services website has a spot for you to apply. And many are familiar with that website who have received Phase 2 and Phase 3 funds. It's a very similar process. The only wrinkle in this one is that you have to get your identification number verified first. And they'll run that against the database of medical providers in order to continue on the process. Now, they're saying that could take up to 4 days. So really, they're wanting, and in a recent webcast, they said they are wanting people to start this early so that there is enough time to get all the information gathered and submitted on time.
So if you're talking about a government entity that says they need 4 days, so that's a week.
Yeah, I would say.
So that's a week.
Yeah.
And so if, you know, if we'll put this podcast out soon, but, you know, the urgency.
Yeah, certainly.
Okay. Is it pretty extensive, the paperwork?
No, it's not too bad. Now, it is a little broader than other phases where other phases have focused in on a certain quarter. What you'll generally do is submit your last filed practice tax return, as well as your, in this case, you're going to submit 3/4 of profit and loss that are the last 2 quarters of 2020 and the 1st quarter of 2021, plus comparable quarters of 2019, because they want to see how it compares to see if you did kind of suffer a loss both on the revenue side and increased expenses. And that's what they're focused on in their evaluation.
So if you could have a good dental CPA, you can get that information within the hour. Those who have a poor standard of care, it might take another week to get that from their team. And then if they have to do the cross-reference, that can be another week. So this, when you talk about time urgency, that there is something to that. Now, so it's fairly extensive, mm-hmm. but manageable for folks to do. How will they evaluate how much to give each applicant?
Like I mentioned, they will be seeing how your revenue was affected in Q2, Q3 of 2020 and Q1 of 2021 versus the similar revenue and expense comparison for 2019, which was generally a clean year. But for 2020, as we know, there has been a decrease in revenues, an increase in even COVID-related expenses or general expenses. And so while it's not a definite formula, that's generally what they're saying they're going to evaluate. Now, I will say there are two components to this application. One is that it's that general analysis of how revenues and expenses have gone. And then the second one is a rural component. And that is that if you are serving folks that live in rural communities, then you can also get a distribution related to that. Now, it doesn't mean that your office has to be in a rural location. It just means that you may be serving rural communities. Now, you may not know if they live in a rural community. So basically what the HHS recommends is if you want to be considered for this rural distribution, go ahead and check a box that you want to be considered, and it will have through its magical database figuring out if you have rural clients. Now, it's generally rural clients that are on some sort of government help, such as Medicare, Medicaid, CHIP, that kind of thing. So,
why does it matter if somebody's a rural patient?
They feel that rural patients may be underserved and that they may not have the means to.
And they have to drive farther.
Right. They have to drive farther, and that there aren't as many healthcare providers for rural folks.
It sounds like our government underestimating the ingenuity of the citizens. I'm having a hard time making this connection. Like,
right.
There's a farmer that lives in a rural area and they don't think they can hop in their truck and drive 20 miles to get their tooth fixed.
I'm not really sure what their thinking is there, but they've have this carve out.
So. Fascinating.
Yeah.
Fascinating. That's why we have you on. I'm learning things as I go. Wow, a rural bonus.
Right.
All right, so let me say this. Let me ask you, if I get the payment, right?
Yes.
From there, what would be the next step? Okay. Once I have them, I just start spending?
Well, hold on, Jarrod, that's a great question, but I had a hypothetical that I wanted to ask before I went on my rural tangent. So let's say in 2019, quarter one, $150,000 in revenue.
Okay.
In 20, $50,000.
Okay.
In 21, back to 150.
Okay.
They apply for this. Are they going to get any money?
Well, we're not quite sure. What they're going to compare quarter to quarter. So let's say quarter one 2019 is going to be compared with quarter one of 2021. So then quarter.
So how about if they're very similar?
if they're very similar. Well, there's different factors. So there's not a clear formula, and some may be denied, but it's definitely worth applying for just in case. And there is that magical formula where they will receive the funds.
There's a rural component.
There is a rural component. That might be the big bonus they're hoping for. So
the message is apply. Mm-hmm. But there's a big unknown if this is what this could look like.
Absolutely. Because there hasn't been a huge amount of guidance for the prior two. Typically, what they've said in the prior two is that we're going to go with just 2% of your revenues, and that's it. But this is a little more ambiguous as far as what might actually come to you.
Interesting. Jarrod, what was your question again that you wanted to ask?
Oh, man, it was so important. No, but it is. So, okay. It was, you know, if I receive the money, what's the next step?
So the next step, and this also applies to prior distributions in phase two and phase three. What you have to do is attest that you accept the money, and this is done online. Once you receive the money, you have to attest that you receive the money and that you agree to terms and conditions. Now, this is similar to
What are these terms and conditions?
Okay,
are these the strings attached?
Is this the thing at the end of like a web page? I just kind of click check and
not quite. There are steps to take once you receive. Now, the terms and conditions that you are agreeing to are really that you're going to not spend it wildly. You're going to spend it on your practice, which you will, or it's to replace revenues. So it's generally going to go in your practice. You're not going to go spend like some PPP recipients have spent on Lamborghinis and wild things like that. You're not going to go with that. You're not going to spend it on anything illegal.
How about if you had an in-house masseuse for your dental practice and patients that come from a rural area who are just so exhausted from that car ride?
Right. Now we're really combining elements and business purpose, that's what they're looking for. So if there's a true business purpose for any of what you said, then you can go for it.
A lot of creativity. Yeah. I mean, you know, as a kid, the terms and conditions to getting gifts from Santa Claus was you had to be a good boy or girl.
Mm-hmm.
And so understanding the terms and conditions of this free money is good to know. So business purpose, that's business the criteria.
So you still have to be a good boy or girl.
And you can be creative.
You can be creative. Certainly, like if you need equipment, that's something that can be done. If really it's just going to your bottom line, your normal expenses that you would have spent before. There's also a reporting requirement, which is done for, it's going to be coming for phase two and phase three recipients too, where it's going to explain this is what you use the purpose for, this is what you use the funds for. It's, you didn't spend it on anything lavish, that kind of thing. But that we're going to see more of what that means later on. But with each of these phase distributions, there is that reporting that's going to be needed, which it really isn't anything. And we're going to do that for our clients. So it's not a big deal.
Well, good. Well, Steve, I appreciate you coming in here again. Time sensitive information and opportunity for practice owners, and you know, primarily our listeners to be able to apply for this and potentially get some funds to put back into practice to help with the practice. And that's a good thing. Anything else that we haven't covered that we need to mention about this?
One thing that I learned in a recent webinar is that HHS really wants people to receive this. And they are thankful that dental providers and other healthcare providers are really on the front lines of providing services for the public in these trying conditions. And they stress that we thank you for all your efforts. And this is their thank you. This is the government's thank you for those efforts.
That's sweet. What did Ronald Reagan say? His famous quote, the 9 scariest words in the English language. I'm from the government and I'm here to help.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. No, I joke, but hopefully. But when you said terms and conditions, my antennas went up. But so the government just genuinely wants to help and thank people. That's wonderful.
They really do.
Fantastic. Steve, thanks for joining. Jarrod, that massage business, I'm telling you, bud. All right.
Excellent. Thank you.
That's all the time we have today. Thank you to our guests for their insight and for sharing some really great information. And thank you to you, the listener, for tuning in. The Millionaire Dentist Podcast is brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. To see if they might be a good fit for you and your practice, go on over to fourquadrantsadvisory.com and see why year after year they retain over 95% of their clients. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.